صلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ونبينا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن هذا القرآن يهدي للتي هي أقوم ويبشر المؤمنين الذين يعملون الصالحات أن لهم أجرا كبيرا وأن الذين لا يؤمنون بالآخرة أعتدنا لهم عذابا أليما. وقال تعالى، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ألف لام ميم، ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون والذين يؤمنون بما أنزل إليك وما أنزل من قبلك وبالآخرة هم يوقنون أولئك على هدى من ربهم وأولئك هم المفلحون. صدق الله العظيم. اللهم إنا نسألك علما نافعا ورزقا واسعا وعملا متقبلا وشفاء من كل داء. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن نفس لا تشبع ومن دعوة لا يستجاب لها. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. رب زدني علما. Respected brothers and sisters, all praise is due to Allah Azza wa Jal, the Lord of the worlds, the Creator and Master of the heavens and the earth, who revealed the Quran as a criterion and as the final message and as a source of guidance and mercy upon Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. May Allah's blessings and salutations be upon him and his companions and all those who follow them in excellence until the day of judgment. The topic allocated to me is the Quran, solution for humanity. I had discussed with the brothers organizing the program, we either call the program Mercy for Humanity or Solution for Humanity. But whatever the case is, inshallah, I should try with the help of Allah and with the tawfiq of Allah to mention a number of points regarding the Quran, the message of the Quran, and understanding the Quran itself. First, we need to understand what the Quran is. What does the Quran stand for? And the status the Quran holds in Islam. Now, to understand the Quran, we refer to the Quran itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He opens the Quran, when He begins the Quran, He gives an introduction to the Quran itself. Alif Lam Mim, Dhalika al-Kitabu la rayba fihi hudan lil-muttaqin. Allah says Alif Lam Mim, Dhalika al-Kitabu la rayba fihi. This is the book wherein there is no doubt. Hudan lil-muttaqin, it is a guide for those who want to seek the path of taqwa, who are wishing to better their relationship with their Creator and with their Master. So when we pick up a book, the first thing we do is to check the author, to check how credible this book is, so we can look, is this book worthy of being followed, is this book worthy of being adopted. So the Quran is such that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right from the beginning, He says, this is the book wherein there is no doubt. So whatever follows from these first few passages, right till the end of the book, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the book in such a way that there are no discrepancies, it doesn't contradict, one part doesn't contradict the other, there is no doubt whatsoever. Because it has been revealed from Allah, the Lord of the heavens and the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the Quran as al-Quran al-Hakim, Yasin wal-Quran al-Hakim. This book is full of wisdom, and whoever reads this book, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will also inspire this person with wisdom as well. Al-Dhikr al-Hakim, this is the wise reminder. This is a remembrance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. Allah says that the nur and the light has come to you from Allah and a clear book. The Quran is very clear, it's very decisive, the meanings are very straightforward and simple to understand. It is al-Furqan, it is the criterion. It differentiates between falsehood and truth. It differentiates between that which is right and wrong. Hablullah. Allah says, وَعَتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. Hold firm onto the rope of Allah. If we look at the explanation given by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the hadith, he says that Hablullah is the rope of Allah, is the Quran. The Quran is the rope of Allah. One end of the rope is with Allah, and the other end of the rope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed on earth. Whoever holds firm onto this rope, he has connected himself, he has affiliated himself, and he has established a strong link and bond with his Creator and with his Master. Allah says, the Ahsan al-Hadith, this is the best of all speeches. Hudan lil-muttaqeen, It's a guide for those people who are seeking taqwa, the fear of God. Bayanul linnas. Hada bayanul linnas. Wa hudan wa maw'idatun lil muttaqin. Allah says that this book is an explanation for mankind, and it is a guidance and it is a reminder for those who are seeking taqwa. Allah calls this book Sirat al-Mustaqim, As-Sirat al-Mustaqim. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this book is the straight path. Al-Qawl al-Fasl, this is the decisive speech. There is no element of any kind of joke or any kind of jest in here. It's very firm, it's very decisive. There's no aspect of anything to be taken lightly in the Quran. Al-Naba'ul Azeem, Allah says, Qul huwa Naba'ul Azeem. This book is the great news. We look at the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Fihi Naba'u ma qablakum. That this book contains the stories and the accounts of the people who passed before you. The people of Nuh alayhi salam, Noah. The people of Ibrahim, Abraham. Moses, Musa. Ishaq, Ismail. And all the other prophets, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has related their stories in great detail throughout the Quran. And we find that in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in particular the story of Musa alayhi salam, Moses, and Isa alayhi salam, Jesus in particular. We find there is a whole surah dedicated to the mother of Jesus, Maryam. Maryam is the Islamic name or the Arabic name for Mary. A whole story is dedicated to Maryam and Isa alayhi salam, in which the account of the birth of Isa alayhi salam, how his mother was secluded in the Al-Bayt al-Maqdis in Jerusalem, and how she left from there once she became pregnant, and she went and she gave birth. All this is given in great detail in the Quran in Surah Maryam. So this is Al-Naba'ul Azeem. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relates the stories of the previous prophets and the previous nations in the Quran. Rahmatul lil mu'mineen. It's a mercy for anyone who believes in the Quran. Quran an arabiyyan ghayra dhi 'iwajin la'allahum yattaqun. Allah says that this Quran is in Arabic, bilisan in arabiyyin mubeen. Elsewhere Allah says the Quran is in very clear, very distinct Arabic, ghayra dhi 'iwajin. There is no element of crookedness or any kind of wrong in the Quran. The Quran is very straightforward, it's very simple to understand. So these are a few words we understand from the Quran, which we have taken from the Quran, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is introducing the Quran and explaining the status of the Quran. Now, the Quran, we look at all the verses of the Quran, we understand the significance of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the Quran a very revolutionary and dynamic book. And it affects the hearts and minds of people, anyone who listens to the Quran, anyone who understands the Quran, anyone who seeks guidance in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala definitely guides a person who seeks and who looks for guidance in the Quran. Allah says, إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَذِكْرَى لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْقَ السَّمْعَ وَهُوَ شَهِيدٌ. That verily in this Quran, there is guidance and there is a reminder for that person who has a heart, a person who has a sound heart, a person who is looking for guidance. Allah will definitely guide this person to the Quran. So if a person looks without being biased, remove all the kind of misconceptions a person may have regarding the Quran, look at it in a very unbiased manner, and approach the Quran in a neutral manner, and this Quran is going to be a means of guidance for a person. It's a means of inspiration for a person. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed the knowledge of the first and the last in the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected the Quran from all forms of misconstruences, all kinds of corruption. No kind of corruption or any element of doubt or change can enter the Quran. Allah says, لا يأتيه الباطل من بين يديه ولا من خلفه. That the Quran is such, Allah has protected it in such a manner that falsehood can neither approach the Quran from behind or from the front. Allah has protected the Quran from all aspects. And the Quran is miraculous in nature. I want to highlight how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the Quran miraculous in its nature. And when we understand the miraculous nature of the Quran, this itself will help us understand how the Quran presents a solution for humanity, presents a solution for the problems that we see around us, and how the Quran is a source of guidance and inspiration at times of difficulty, at times of distress, and when we are seeking some kind of solution to our problems. The first point we understand regarding the Quran is the eloquence and the style of the Quran, the style of the Arabic and the phenomenal nature of the Quranic Arabic. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Quran was revealed, it was revealed in Mecca, right in the desert, and the people of Arabia in particular the people of Makkah, were very eloquent. Their language, their eloquence, their understanding of the Arabic language, and especially their poetry was something they prided themselves upon. We find that every year, great poets from all across Arabia used to gather in particular markets, in particular fairs, and they would present their poetry. And in presenting their poetry, whoever came with the best poetry, whoever presented the best pieces of poetry, their poetry would be prepared and it would be placed upon the Kaaba. The Kaaba was the center of all devotion and worship in the sacred land, and everyone respected the Kaaba. Now it was a great honor and privilege for a person to have his poetry placed upon the Kaaba, and this would be placed for until the next year. So this is where you have the As-Sabr al-Mu'allaqat, which are probably the most important pieces of Arabic literature and poetry. As-Sabr al-Mu'allaqat means the seven which are hung. The seven pieces of poetry which were hung upon the Kaaba. So now the Arabs were experts in poetry, and they would be able to, without any kind of preparation, improvise and say many lengthy pieces of poetry without any kind of preparation. This is how gifted they were in this aspect of poetry. But when the Quran came, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran upon Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, may Allah's blessings and peace be upon him. Now they leveled many accusations against the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They called him a madman, they called him a soothsayer, they called him a magician, they called him a poet. But they understood deep down that there is no way that they can challenge the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said very clearly in the Quran that قُلْ فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاءَكُمْ مِّن دُونِ اللَّهِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. That the Arabs are saying the Quran has been fabricated. Muhammad has taken the Quran from certain Christian priests or monks, or he has gone to a certain place and he has been told the Quran. إِنَّمَا يُعَلِّمُهُ بَشَرٌ. The Quran relates the statement and the speech of the people of Makkah that he's been taught by a man. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very boldly and very clearly put the challenge that if you are saying this Quran has been fabricated, it's been forged, and Muhammad has taken this from others, فَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِ. Bring a surah similar to the Quran, the smallest surah of the Quran. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwal abtar. That's it. That's the shortest surah in the Quran. I read that within a matter of 10 seconds. So the Quran is saying, Allah Azza wa Jal is saying that if you claim this Quran is the speech of man, then bring something like this. Bring something which is similar or even equal, even resembles very slightly the Quran in its nature. Something which is as short as 3 verses. So inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwal abtar. Bring something as short as that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says very clearly, فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا وَلَمْ تَفْعَلُوا. That if you cannot do so, and never will you be able to do so. Allah say, puts the challenge that if you cannot do so, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also answers the challenge and says, and you will never be able to do so. And it's true till today, nobody has ever been able to come up with anything similar to the Quran. Whoever has tried to do anything, even bring a small verse which shares the same eloquence and the style and the excellence of the Quranic verse, he has failed miserably. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has not allowed this to take place, because this is the direct speech of Allah himself, this is the direct speech of the Creator and the Master, and there is nothing that can match or even compare or even resemble to the slightest the eloquence and the style of the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places this challenge over and over again in the Quran. Never has this challenge been matched till today. Walid ibn Mughira was one of the staunchest enemies of Islam. He was one of the staunchest enemies of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he placed every obstacle in the path of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to try and stop the cause of Islam spreading and the message of the Quran being propagated and entering the hearts and minds of people. So Walid ibn Mughira, despite being such a staunch enemy, he once heard the verse إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ. Very simply, Allah, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى. Allah orders عَدْلٍ بِالْعَدْلِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ. Allah orders equality and justice. وَالْإِحْسَانِ, and excellence and being good to others. وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, and giving and sharing with one relatives. with one's relatives. وَيَنْهَىٰ عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbids from fahsha, lewdness, وَالْمُنْكَرِ and all forms of evil, وَالْبَغْيِ and oppression. When Walid ibn al-Mughira, the staunch enemy of Islam, when these verses fell upon his ears, he said, وَاللَّهِ إِنَّ لَهُ لَحَلَاوَةٌ. That this speech has a sweetness to it. وَإِنَّ عَلَيْهِ لَطَلَاوَةٌ. And this Quran, these verses of which Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is presenting, it has a certain charm about it, it has a certain charisma about it. And he says that if you look at the bottom of this, it's like a tree beneath which a spring is flowing. There's abundant good at the bottom, and the branches of this tree bear fruit, and they bear excellent fruit. And he said, Wallah, by Allah, this is not the speech of a human. This can never be the speech of a human. So despite the fact that they were very strong enemies of the Quran, and they tried everything to stop the Quran spreading, but they had to admit and confess to the fact that this Quran does not resemble the speech of men. It cannot be anything but something divine. So this is these are those who oppose the Quran. It is their confession. It is they are admitting to the fact that the Quran is the speech of Allah, and it is something which cannot be matched. Umar radiallahu anhu, the second Khalifa of Islam, he was once sleeping in a masjid, and he awoke to find that there is somebody standing by his head, and he is reading Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. He's reading the testimony of faith. So Umar al-Faruq doesn't recognize this person and says, who are you? He said that I am one of the Roman soldiers, and I've come here to accept Islam. Umar radiallahu anhu asks him, what's your story? How have you come here to accept Islam? He said, we had a number of Muslim prisoners, and I once heard one of the prisoners reciting one verse of your book, and I contemplated this verse, and I understood and I realized that this verse has gathered and it encompasses all the good of this life and the hereafter, which was revealed upon Isa alayhi salam, which was revealed upon Jesus. And this one verse made me think that if this is one verse which has gathered all the teachings of Jesus, of Isa alayhi salam, then imagine the truthfulness and the profoundness of the rest of the book, and he accepted Islam. This verse was, وَمَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ وَيَخْشَ اللَّهَ وَيَتَّقْهِ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَائِزُونَ. Whoever obeys Allah and his messenger, وَيَخْشَ اللَّهَ, and he fears Allah, وَيَتَّقْهِ, and he ensures that he fulfills the commands of Allah, فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْفَائِزُونَ. These are those people who have attained success. So this is the miraculous nature of the Quran. One aspect of the miraculous nature of the Quran is the eloquence and the style of language which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed in the Quran. The second aspect of the Quran and its being a miracle is that the Quran has been protected and it's in its pristine and original form over 1400 centuries. And this is something which has been attested to by not just by Muslims. This is not just Muslims who say that the Quran is protected. Even non-Muslim historians such as William Muir, he says that the Quran is a book which has been protected over, he says 12 centuries because he lived a number of centuries ago. He says over 12 centuries the Quran has not been changed, and it's in the original form in which the Quran was compiled. And he says that no other book in history stands this test, where it remains unchanged over such a long period of time. And this is the divine protection for the Quran, which Allah Himself assured. Allah says, "Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikr wa inna lahu lahafidun." Verily, we have revealed this reminder, "Wa inna lahu lahafidun." And it is us who are going to protect the Quran. And Allah Subhanahu wa Taala has protected this Quran right throughout the centuries. And we find it's amazing to find that Allah has protected this Quran right throughout the centuries through people. Allah has made, in every community you find, you go to Coventry, you go to Birmingham, you go to Leicester or any of the towns, and you go to any Muslim community, any Muslim locality, and you will find within this locality there reside 10, 15, 20, up to 100 people who have memorized the whole Quran from beginning to end. You will find children at the age of 5, 6, 7 who have memorized the Quran despite having no understanding whatsoever of the Quran. I can relate about myself. I started memorizing the Quran when I was 14 and I finished it when I was 18. Now when I was studying the Quran, when I was memorizing the Quran, I had no knowledge whatsoever regarding the meaning of the Quran. I never understood what the Arabic means. I never understood the grammar, nothing whatsoever. I just knew how to recite the Quran and read the words. But otherwise, what the Quran means, what each verse I'm memorizing stands for, I had no clue whatsoever. But this is the miracle of the Quran. It's nothing to do with me, or it's nothing to do with the people who memorize the Quran. This is the miracle of the Quran and the preservation of the Quran, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made such people who memorize the Quran, regardless of how young they are in age or how old they are. Just a few weeks ago, one of my friends from Birmingham, his mother, who is 63 years old, she completed memorizing the Quran. Now, she's 63 years old, it took her 2 years, and she memorized the whole Quran. Now, I'm not sure if everyone understands or appreciates how long the Quran is. It's approximately, it's over 6,000 verses, 6,400 according to some, and a number of different narrations, exactly how many verses of the Quran there are. But over 6,000 verses of the Quran, and the Quran spans over 600 pages. So it's not easy to memorize the Quran, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has protected the Quran, and Allah himself says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. We have made the Quran easy to remember. Is there anyone to remember? We have made the Quran easy to remember. Is there anyone to remember the Quran, to memorize the Quran, to retain the Quran to memory? So this is also part of the protection of the Quran, and the Quran has been preserved to such an extent. To the extent that the science of how to recite the Quran, this has also been preserved. It's known as the science of Tajweed. So we have a whole science in which we understand how to pronounce each letter, how long the stretch should be on a particular letter, where exactly a particular letter emanates from in the mouth, what's the origin of that letter. So you have, for example, the letter Qaf. Qaf is an Arabic letter. You'll find books which mention the exact point where the letter Qaf originates from. The letter Ba, the letter Mim, the letter Tha, Jim, Ha. All these letters you find in the books of Tajweed, this science of reciting the Quran, and they demonstrate exactly how this letter is pronounced, all the qualities which are found in this particular letter. So even down to this finest detail of how to recite the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has preserved this whole science, and this is how the Quran has been preserved over the centuries. And thirdly, another miracle of the Quran, which is still with us today, is the impact of the Quran. The impact the Quran has upon a person who listens to the Quran. The impact the Quran had upon those people upon whom the Quran was revealed, the first recipients of the Quran, and even people today who listen to the Quran. The Quran is such that it does not resemble any kind of poetry. It's very different to poetry. And as the Prophet ﷺ said, وَلَا يَغْلُقُ عَنْ كَثْرَةِ الرَّتْبِ. That no matter how many times you repeat the Quran, a person can keep reciting the Quran, never will a person tire from the Quran. And the Quran is so dynamic, it's so profound, it's so rich, it's so diverse and vast in meaning, that the more a person delves into the Quran, the more a person studies the Quran, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens the meanings of the Quran upon a person. That's why you find many commentaries of the Quran, you'll find explanations and commentaries of the Quran, and they number thousands. And even today, we find that new commentaries are being written on the Quran. This is how rich the Quran is, and this is also a miracle of the Quran. Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, the second Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the intention he left with. He has taken his sword, he has brandished his sword, he's heading towards the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He meets a person. This person says to him, where are you going? He said, well, I'm going to finish off this religion of Islam. I've had enough. This person is causing so many problems. He's caused so many problems within our community, that mothers and fathers and daughters and sons are being separated from one another. I want to put an end to this religion. So this person says to him, that why are you worried about Muhammad? Go sort your own family out first. He said, what do you mean sort my own family out? He said, your own sister and your brother-in-law have accepted Islam. Umar ibn Khattab, known for his anger, known for his strength, he rushes towards the house of his sister. His sister hears her brother outside of the door, and she understands the temperament of her brother. So she quickly stops reading the Quran, and Khubayb, who was the companion teaching them the Quran, he quickly hid in the chamber on the side. Umar ibn Khattab walks in and said, what sister are you reading? I heard you reading something. She said, nothing, we weren't reading anything. He begins to hit his sister, and his sister begins to bleed. When he sees his sister bleeding, he feels some remorse, and his anger cools down. The sister says to him that you can do what you want, we are never going to leave the religion of Islam. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu said, give me the Quran, make me hear those verses as well that you're reading. She said, no, go become clean first, become ritually clean, and then I will give you this parchment upon which the Quran is written. He goes, he takes a shower, he comes back, and he hears the verses, Taha, ma anzalna alaykum al-Quran litashqa illa tadhkiratan liman yakhsha. He just hears these very simple verses of the Quran. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu says that these verses penetrated my heart, they pierced his heart, and straight away he resolved to become a follower of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He now heads towards the house of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with the intention of accepting Islam. He embraces, and the Muslims are rejoiced upon the acceptance of Umar into Islam. So this is how the Quran, there are many stories like this. Just recently, a number of decades ago, Jamal Abdel Nasser, who was at that time the president of Egypt, he took one of the very famous reciters of the Quran, Abdul Basit, his name was. So Abdul Basit accompanied Jamal Abdel Nasser to Russia. And they had a meeting there. Now, the president, Jamal Abdel Nasser, he requested that Abdul Basit, this famous reciter, be given a chance to recite some verses of the Quran. Abdul Basit, he recited verses of the Quran, and many members of the cabinet who were sitting there, they were reduced to tears. They were crying. They were asked, why are you crying? You don't even understand the meaning of the Quran. You don't understand the words of the Quran. They said that this is just the impact of the Quran, the profoundness of the Quran. It's left an impression upon us. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed this effect in the recitation of the Quran. So when the Quran is miraculous in such a way, then the solution which the Quran presents are also miraculous. The solution which the Quran presents also withstand the test of time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions a number of things in the Quran which we can use as solutions for the problems that we see today. I'll just give you a number of teachings of the Quran, which are very common teachings which each and every person can implement, and which if we contemplate these teachings of the Quran, we will understand that the Quran calls towards good, it calls towards righteousness, and it calls towards the betterment of society. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ أَخَذْنَا مِيثَاقَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ لَا تَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. Allah says, remember when we took a covenant from the children of Israel, that you will not worship anyone besides Allah, and you shall be good towards your parents, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى, and towards your relatives, وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَبْنِ السَّبِيلِ, and towards the poor and those who are travelling. Throughout the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enjoins upon the believers to respect their parents, to honour their parents, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds people of the right of their parents above them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَوَصَّيْنَا الْإِنسَانَ بِوَالِدَيْهِ, that we enjoin and exhort this person to respect his parents, to honor his parents. Why? Because his mother bore the difficulty of pregnancy, the difficulty of childbirth, and the difficulty of breastfeeding. This in itself is enough for a person to be eternally grateful to his parents. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the right of the orphans. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ أَمْوَالَ الْيَتَامَى ظُلْمًا إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا, that those people who consume the wealth of orphans, who take the wealth of orphans, and they eat it, they consume it, thinking, he's only an orphan, he's helpless, he's weak, he won't be able to stand up against me or defend himself against me. Allah says, إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُونَ فِي بُطُونِهِمْ نَارًا, that these people are consuming hellfire in their stomachs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, the verse I already mentioned, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, that verily Allah orders justice, وَالْإِحْسَانِ, and excellence, being good, وَإِيتَاءِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, giving to one's relatives. وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. 20. وَيَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنكَرِ وَالْبَغْيِ يَعِظُكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he forbids from lewdness, from shamelessness, والفحشاء والمنكر, and evil, والبغي, and oppression. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding life, and the sanctity of life. من أجل ذلك كتبنا على بني إسرائيل أنه من قتل نفسا بغير نفس أو فساد في الأرض فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا. That whoever kills human life without any reason whatsoever, unjustly he kills a human, فكأنما قتل الناس جميعا. It is as though this person has killed the whole of humanity. ومن أحياها فكأنما أحيا الناس جميعا. And whoever revives a human, whoever revives human life, whoever is a source of protecting human life, فَكَأَنَّمَا أَحْيَ النَّاسَ جُمِيعًا. It is as though this person has preserved and protected the whole of humanity. And likewise, we can go throughout the whole Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned clear guidelines on every aspect of life. Firstly, a person's individual relationship with his creator. The Quran mentions many points throughout the Quran in which a person understands his relationship with Allah, his relationship with his master, with his creator, and how to better himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given very clear guidelines on married life. Allah says, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, that deal with your wives in an excellent manner. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rights of the husband over the wife and the rights of the wife over the husband. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the rights of the children over the parents. The rights of maintenance, who is responsible for maintaining the children, and who is responsible for all these things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned them in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned the rules of inheritance. So a person passes away, who deserves the inheritance, and according to what share does each person deserve this inheritance. All these things are clearly detailed in the Quran. To the extent that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ, that don't consume each other's wealth unjustly. So we find today, we're living in an age where every person will try, or most people will try, to squeeze every penny out of their customer. And you find so many things happening out there where people are dishonest, people are treacherous in their dealings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly points out that this is forbidden in Islam. Islam exhorts justice, truthfulness, and being honest in all one's actions. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُونُوا قَوَّامِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ. O you who believe, be firm upon truth, upon justice, شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ, be witnesses unto Allah. Even if it means that you have to give witness against yourself, against your parents, against your relatives, if it comes for the sake of the truth and the cause of truth, make sure that you are truthful, you don't lie, you don't deceive anyone. So these are all the teachings of Islam, and this is what the Quran presents. Many different things we can mention regarding the Quran and how it presents the solution to humanity. But very simply, in a 45-minute speech or 40-minute speech, it's not possible to try and encompass all the different teachings of the Quran and to cover all the different aspects of the Quran and the teaching of the Quran. Just some basic guidelines regarding the Quran. My humble advice to anyone who wants to understand the Quran and to understand the solution the Quran presents and to understand what the Quran signifies, read the Quran. Read the Quran, pick up a reliable commentary or translation of the Quran, preferably with a commentary. Translation on its own is sometimes not sufficient. You need to pick up a commentary which explains the verses of the Quran, the context of of a particular verse, and hopefully that will open up a lot of avenues to understanding the Quran. It will open up the understanding and appreciation of what the Quran stands for, the wisdom contained within the Quran, and it will be a means of appreciating the guidance and the inspiration and the direction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in the Quran. I'm going to finish, inshallah, just with a recitation of the Quran, just so people understand how the Quran is recited. And I would advise everyone, regardless of their faith, of their background, to listen to the Quran. The Quran is something, if a person listens to the Quran, it's a source of inspiration, and you will find that it has a deep impact on a person. Just listening to the Quran, it's very easy to find recitation of the Quran on the internet or from an Islamic bookstore or elsewhere. Listen to the Quran and appreciate the beauty of the Quran and appreciate the deepness of the Quran. The Quran is such as the Prophet said, لا يخلق عن كثرة قراءة. You can listen to it over and over again. You can read it over and over again. You can try to understand it over and over again. But never will you become bored, never will you tire of the Quran. This is the nature of the Quran. May Allah make wise and beneficial for one and all. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to understand and appreciate the message contained in the Quran. Inshallah, I shall recite just a small portion of the Quran. This is known. This surah is known as Surah Rahman. And this Surah Rahman is a surah. Rahman means the most merciful. And in this surah, in this chapter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enumerating His favors and His blessings upon mankind. And after a few verses, or every other verse, Allah asks the question, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءُ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. That which of the favors of your Lord are you going to deny? So this is one of the most beautiful surahs of the Quran. Inshallah, I shall recite this surah. And I request everyone to listen attentively, listen with an open heart, and listen with full attention. Inshallah, may Allah make it beneficial.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الرحمن علم القرآن. خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. الشمس والقمر بحسبان. والنجم والشجر يسجدان. والسماء رفعها ووضع الميزان. ألا تطغوا في الميزان. وأقيموا الوزن بالقسط ولا تخسروا الميزان. والأرض وضعها للأنام. فيها فاكهة والنخل ذات الأكمام. والحب ذو العصف والريحان. فبأي آلاء ربكما تكذبان. خلق الإنسان من صلصال كالفخار. وخلق الجان من مارج من نار. فبأي آلام